Es para mí realmente un inmenso placer presentar a la oradora de la primera conferencia plenaria de esta octava MASI, la doctora Mabel Tidwell. La doctora Tidwell es egresada de la licenciatura en matemática de Rosario y también del doctorado en Rosario. Hizo el doctorado bajo la dirección del doctor Roberto González. Yo creo que fue la primera egresada del doctorado que desarrolló todas sus actividades durante el doctorado en Rosario, trabajando y viviendo en la ciudad. Sobre la tesis fue sobre control óptimo, métodos numéricos para la resolución de la ecuación de Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman. Luego de obtener su doctorado, hizo varios séjours de investigación en Francia y durante un tiempo estuvo yendo y viniendo entre Francia y Rosario, más precisamente entre varios séjours en Sofía, en el INRI de Sofía Antipolis. Y posteriormente, al principio a lo mejor pasaba más tiempo en Rosario y menos en Francia, después eso fue mutando y fue pasando más tiempo en Francia. Durante ese tiempo fue docente en la Universidad Nacional de Rosario. Ya en el 2000 ingresa como investigadora junior en el INRA, en el Instituto Nacional de Recherche Agronomique, en Montpellier, en el Departamento de Economía. Entonces, al desarrollar sus actividades ahí, también comenzó su interés por las cuestiones económicas y las cuestiones económicas ligadas a la producción y a los problemas provenientes de las cuestiones de agronomía. En el 2005 pasa su habilitación para dirigir tesis en economía en la Universidad de Montpellier. Y desde entonces ha publicado más de 80 trabajos, ha dirigido 7 tesistas, ha publicado un libro sobre el tema conjetura variacional, del cual va a tratar ahora en la conferencia, y sigue dedicándose al control óptimo, a la teoría de juegos, a los problemas que tienen que ver medioambientales y de producción de cuestiones agronómicas y recursos renovables y no renovables. Y bueno, realmente es un gran placer tenerla a ella, que la conozco desde, iba a decir desde chiquita, pero sigo siendo muy bajita, así que la conozco desde siempre, desde que empecé mi vida en la matemática. Así que bueno, Mabel, te cedo la palabra y muchas gracias por estar dándonos esta conferencia aquí en la MASI.
Bueno, no me hagas llorar, Elena. Muchas gracias. Yo te conozco desde chiquita, en realidad, pero bueno, en todo caso, muchísimas gracias. Estoy muy contenta de que seas vos que me haya presentado y muchas gracias por esas lindas palabras. Y bueno, cuando quieran, muchas gracias por haberme invitado, Pablo, y a todos, por supuesto, los organizadores que me han ayudado para conectarme, que yo no soy muy buena para estas cosas de la informática. Así que muchísimas gracias. Puedo comenzar cuando ustedes sí, me digan.
Compartiendo más, si quieres, Mabel.
Comparto.
Poniendo en pantalla completa. Perfecto.
Yes. Okay. Well, I think that I'm going to switch in English. The idea of this talk is to present you a panorama of the theory of conjectural variations and its applications to natural resource management. I am going to tell you what we can do with this theory, give you some results, and conclude with a lot of things that we can still do. Before to talk about conjectures, I want to remind you two concepts that I am going to use in this talk, Nash equilibrium and cooperative or Pareto solution. The Nash equilibrium is the most common way to define the solution of a non-cooperative game involving two or more players. In a Nash equilibrium, each player is assumed to know the equilibrium strategies of the other players, and no player has anything to gain by changing only her own strategy. In this case, a player has a profit function that depends on the strategy of all the players. The player maximizes his profit function in his strategy and obtain the best response. All the players make the same, and the equilibrium is the intersection of all these best responses. In the other hand, this is a non-cooperative way to play. In the other hand, we can have cooperative solution. In cooperative solution, players have the opportunity to communicate between them and commit to cooperate before defining the strategy to be adopted. Or perhaps a regulator takes this into account and try to find the best solution following some objective. In general, in this case, this objective is the sum of the payoff of all the players. In the first case, this is an equilibrium. In this case, this is an optimal control problem, because, or an optimization problem if we are in an static setting. Now, I am going to talk about conjecture. What are conjecture? What are conjectural variations? It is a game theoretical concept in which players have a conjecture about the behavior of their opponents. They think that the others will play in function of their own decision. And what is important, this concept? What it is useful for? Because we can see that we are going to see that this is an possible alternative to Nash equilibrium, and can model the behavior of agents that are not so rational. And of course, they are going to explain the behavior that we can see as the results in empirical studies. This concept is very important, especially when information is incomplete. We say that information is incomplete when one player does not know the payoff function of the other player. Also, with this concept, we are going to explain implicit cooperation even when agents behave non-cooperatively. And we are going to see that conjectural variation can be a shorthand for dynamic interactions. I am going to divide my talk in three parts. In the first one, I am going to tell you the definition of conjectural variations in a static setting. In the second part, I am going to talk about consistent conjectures in dynamic games, to finish with conjectures and learning. The first part. I am not going to give you a lot of references, because there is many, many references, but I want to see that Bolle in 1924 was the first economist that talk about this concept in his book, The Mathematical Groundwork of Economics. A bit later, in 1981, Bresnahan gave another important concept of this theory, the concept of consistency that I am going to talk. And his paper was published in a very important economic journal, American Economic Review. There are many, many, many economic papers in the 80s about this concept. But also mathematicians was interested in this concept, and you can find a very, very nice memorandum of Gertjan Olsder, also in 1981, called A Critical Analysis of a New Equilibrium Concept. This was very, very people were very, very interested in this concept in the 80s. Okay, I'm going to tell you what is a conjectural variation. We are going to consider two players in order to make simplification. Each player has a payoff, pi I, and EI is the strategy of player I. We consider that there is some benchmark, EB, and we assume that player I thinks that if he deviates from his benchmark by some infinitesimal quantity, this quantity, then player J, the other player, will react by deviating from his benchmark in a quantity Ri, for some function Ri that depends on the benchmark profile. And we say that Ri is the conjectural variation assumed by player I. But what happens if we have non-infinitesimal deviations? Player I is logically led to think that if he deviates, then player G will play a function that is the solution of this partial differential equation, where Ri is the conjectural variation. Here we have the function with initial condition that say that if I play the benchmark, the other player is going to play his benchmark. And this is key, I am going to call key the conjecture function or the conjecture to sample simply. For example, here the very easy example. If the conjectural variation is constant, this is my deviation, and this is the deviation, this minus the benchmark is the deviation of the other player. And this is the conjectural variation, and this is the conjecture. Now the definition. We say that a pair of variational conjectures, Ri, together with a pair of strategies, is a general conjectural variation equilibrium if this pair of strategy is the solution of this optimization problem. And I say optimization problem because here player I maximizes his profit function in his strategy by thinking that the other player is going to play his conjecture that depends on his strategy. Here, the only thing that appears in his profit function is his strategy, and this is an optimization problem. Both player makes the same, and we say the solution of both these two optimization problem is the conjectural variation equilibrium. Okay, first the positive points of this definition. It is not necessary to know the payoff of the other player in order to compute the equilibrium. For Nash, we need to know the reaction function of the other player to compute the intersection of the above reaction function. Here it's not necessary. Of course, we can find other things that Nash equilibrium, and that is good because in general, empirical findings show that agents do not play Nash equilibrium, but I think that you understand the problem. There is a problem of rationality in this definition, because in this definition, both players are assumed to act as a Stackelberg, but there is not sequentiality. No player observes the open what is are doing the other player because we are in a static framework. And it's a problem that by selecting carefully the conjectures, any outcome can be a conjectural variation equilibrium. So the theory accounts for all observable results. But I say economics work a lot with this concept, and they try to save this concept in the static framework, because they prove that the stationary state of a dynamic game might be summarized by a static conjectural variations equilibrium. The conjecture captures the intertemporal forces of the game. And I am going to show this idea in a very, very simple example. We consider a public goods game. In this game, X is the stock of the public goods. This stock increases with the contribution of all the player. EI is the contribution of player I, and degrades at rate delta. And this is the differential equation that show the evolution of the stock of the public good. Each player has an instantaneous profit of this form, is a function of his contribution and the stock of the public good, and the player maximize the infinite horizon discounted profile. You know, when we solve this, we try to solve this problem, the Nash equilibrium of this problem, we must take into account the strategy that the player uses. We can consider strategies that depends only on time, and we call the solution the open loop equilibrium. But also we can consider strategies that depends on the state variable, and we call this the feedback Nash equilibrium. Well, we can solve this game using these two kinds of strategies, but also we can solve with conjecture this static game at the steady state. At the steady state, players solve the maximization of the instantaneous profit at the steady state, when the evolution is this evolution is equal to zero. Okay? And when solving this, we can write the fair order equations that verifies the solution at the steady state. These fair ones is the solution of the open loop Nash equilibrium, where PA, PE, pi E is the derivative of pi with respect to the contribution, pi X, X is the derivative of the profit function with respect to the state value. This one is the solution of the feedback equilibrium. And the last one is the solution when each player makes a conjectural variation constant and equals to R. And we can see that R can be this quantity or this quantity. So we can say that this is the conjectural variation that the player thought at the steady state. at least in this example, there is a very nice economic interpretation, but it's in terms of the partial derivative of the profit function. As I say, economics per people try to solve this concept, and the other way to solve to save this concept is to endogenize the conjectures, because till now conjectures were given what was in the mind of each player. Now we are going to endogenize the conjectures, and we are going to ask the consistency of the conjectures. Consistency is the requirement that conjectural best responses and conjectural reactions coincide. In other words, what I think the other is going to do, the other player really do. In general, computing a consistent conjectural variation equilibrium requires solving systems of difference or differential equation, and we can use a fixed point theorem to solve this problem. Few solutions are known, and in general, the solution we know are all with constant conjectures. But in particular, I don't know if you understand, but in particular, the nice idea that it is not necessary to know the payoff for the other player is lost with this concept, because in order to have the consistency, we must know the reaction function of the other player. So what's happened with dynamic games now? Inconsistent conjectures, but now in a dynamic setting. Here I present quickly a problem, a discrete time finite horizon problem. We have n players, the time horizon is capital T, x is the vector of the state variable, ei the control of player I in the interval t plus 1, E is the vector of all the controls. The dynamics is given by this equation that say that x t plus 1 is a function of x t and e t, and the payoff is the discount payoff in finite horizon. Now we are going to make conjecture in this problem, in this dynamic problem. Okay, conjecture of player I. He's going to think that the other player, all the other players J, are going to use this strategy function, phi of x. And he thinks this conjecture for each other player. And he puts all these conjectures in the evolution of the state, and has the evolution, his own evolution of the state. Now he faces to an optimal control problem, because the only unknown for him is his best solution, and he can solve it, and we call E star the solution of this optimal control problem, that we suppose that it is unique. He can find his optimal solution, and player I can compute the strategy he thinks the others are going to play. And now we can define two kinds of consistency. The vector of conjecture is a weak control consistent conjectural equilibrium if and only if what I think the control I think the others are going to do is the control that they do. But we are going now to make another kind of consistency. The optimization problem, as I say, you give you a solution, E star of T. But we can rewrite this solution in his feedback function. And we can say that this control is a function phi of X. Don't care. So we are going to see to say that phi, the vector phi of conjecture is a feedback consistent conjectural equilibrium if the reaction function, the real reaction function of player E is the function that the other player have conjecture about him. And what is important now is to see that for differential games or for discrete time games, differential games are games in played in continuous time, open loop Nash equilibria coincide with weak control consistent conjectural equilibrium. When control coincide, this is the same idea of open loop Nash equilibrium, and with the feedback representation coincides, feedback Nash equilibrium coincides with feedback consistent conjectural equilibrium. So if you don't like conjectures, you don't like Nash equilibrium in general, because conjectures are a meta model that where feedback equilibrium and open Nash equilibrium are inside. Ferschmann and Kamian proved this in differential games. At the end of his paper, their paper proposed to consider other kinds of conjectures that they call state and strategy-based conjectures. These strategies, these conjectures are of this form. They are not only a function of the state, but also a function of the control of the player. Taking this into account, we decide to see what happened with this kind of conjecture in a simple example. So we consider a very, very simple example in order to have analytical solution for the conjecture problem and for the Nash equilibrium and the cooperative solution. We consider that X is a non-renewable resource. Ci is the consumption of player I. And this is the maximization problem. This is in discrete time, infinite horizon. This is the evolution of the non-renewable resource that is consumed for both players. There are two players. And each player maximizes in his consumption the discounted consumption via a log function in order to have a linear solution for the Nash equilibrium. But what happens with conjecture? We try to put the idea of Ferschmann and Kamian in this example. Player I conjectures that player J's consumption at period T is given by this expression, this linear expression. If you see, this linear expression in the state variable and in the consumption of player I at time T minus 1. And these parameters are the belief of player I. So if we are going to solve the consistent conjectural problem, the non-cooperative solution, the Nash equilibrium feedback, and the cooperative solution. The consistent conjectural problem is now this one. I put y t plus 1, the consumption of player I at time t, and I can write the evolution of the non-renewal resources in this form. And this is, and we, oh, I'm sorry, I don't know what's happening. And we can solve, we must maximize this infinite horizon problem. And we can find the consistent conjectural equilibrium of this problem. I want to say that in this problem, you can see that the initial consumption of all the players are given. When considering Nash feedback, this is the problem we must solve. In this problem, the only parameter given is the initial state. And here, there is not conjectures. When we solve the cooperative solution, the problem is the same, but now a regulator of both players decide to cooperate and to maximize together in both consumption the sum of the two profit functions. As I said before, in the conjecture model, the optimal consumption depends on the initial consumption level. This implies that one might influence the consumption path that will be chosen by focusing on the initial level of consumption. And if I say this, it's because it is the case, and we can prove that the feedback consistent conjectural equilibrium coincides with the cooperative solution under complete information, provided that the initial level of consumption is the same in both cases. That is, that if agents cooperate initially, then asking for consistency ensures that cooperation will be sustained in the long run. But what happens if the initial consumption is too high? In this case, there is a more aggressive consumption, even more aggressive, even than in the case of the non-cooperative equilibrium. In the opposite, in the other hand, when the initial consumption is sufficiently low, we obtain that these procedures leads to an underexploitation of the resource compared with the cooperative benchmark. We can obtain a better situation of the steady state when we begin with a consumption that is sufficiently low. But in this case, always we need to have the consistency. Now, what happened is we think about learning. In a learning model, we consider always two players. Each player maximizes at each period, again, his profit function, but now we have a dynamic processes here, and this function depends also in state variable. I change a bit the notation here because I am going to make an application to water, so now strategies are W for water, and H is the level of the water table for height. So is an aesthetic setting that I call myopic because they don't take into account really all the dynamic. They don't maximize the infinite horizon problem. They only maximize at each time t. But dynamic evolves on time. So we have this problem for each player. And again, each player at each period makes a conjecture about the behavior of the other player. And we consider that the conjecture is a function of his own strategy, his own action, and the state variable at time t. So, as before, each player solves an optimization problem of this form. He replaces the strategy of the action of the other player by his conjecture. And here appears the state variable also. As before, we call W star the optimal solution for each player, and each player computes the conjecture about the other player that I call WG C star. But in general, the conjecture that player I makes is different than player J do. So player I must adapt his conjecture. To adapt the conjecture, we can consider two different forms. In this one, the functions are adapted based on the most recent observation of the opponent. It's like a Markov processes of learning. In the second one, some statistics is performed on the whole history of observation. We are going to deal in this presentation with this fair kind of learning. And note also that the conjectures are in general functions, but in practical situations that we are going to do is to consider a particular functional form for the conjecture. This functional form will depend on a certain numbers of parameters, and these parameters are going to be learned in the learning procedure. Well, we can prove in general that when this procedure converges, this procedure learns the real action of the other player at the steady state. Also, we can compare these learning procedures with the Nash myopic equilibrium with complete information and with the cooperative solution with complete information. And we can prove that if the conjectures depend only in H, is a function only of the state, this procedure converges to Nash myopic equilibrium in complete information. If the conjectures depend only in W, but if we have also some hypothesis on the learning parameters and of the symmetry of the players, we can find that this process converges to the myopic cooperative solution with complete information. But our idea is not to compare these learning processes in time with myopic solutions. We want to compare this with the infinite horizon problem, the problem that takes into account incomplete information all the time and all the time the evolution of the dynamics that I call the farsighted Nash equilibrium and farsighted cooperative solution. That is the case when we maximize the infinite horizon problem, like I presented before in some examples. And we apply this to a water problem. So here, water is the strategy of the players, is the only input in the production. Pi is the profit function of the player. This is the revenue given by the extraction, but there is also a cost. This cost increase with the level of the water table. This is a marginal cost. This is the total cost. Here we can see that this is the revenue of the net revenue of the player, but we are going to consider also this other term. This term is, we say that a player can also take into account the state of the resource at time, at the next time, at time t plus one. This is a subjective profit to maintain the resource that is going to be used at the next time. And in this case, we call rho. Rho is the discount factor, and gamma I is the resource preferences. In this problem, we can see that the profit depends on the strategies at time t, but also on the state variable at t and t plus one. That's why we call this procedure not myopic, but nearsighted or short-sighted procedures. The evolution of the groundwater is very simple. We say that the level of groundwater at time t plus one is the level at time t plus Rhine, that is constant, minus the extractions. And for these procedures, we consider three different kinds of conjecture. The first one is the useful one that I call affine conjecture in W. When player I deviate of his benchmark, the other deviate in a quantity beta I of his benchmark. But we consider other kind of conjecture that I call imitation or copy W, that say that the other player is going to do like me, more or minus something, beta I. But also we consider a fine conjecture in H that say that I think that the other player is going to extract a proportion of the water table after run. How to evaluate the performance of this learning scheme? We want to do that taking into account environmental and economic concerns. To do that, we consider two quantities. The first one is the steady state of the water table, H infinity, that is going to represent the environment, and the total discounted sum of profit for both players, that is going to be the welfare of the society that I call V infinite. And in the experiments, we are going to represent the result of the simulation in a plane, H infinity, B infinity. Note that the nearsighted solution has gamma as a parameter. The important parameter for me, because it's the parameter that take into account the future of the water table. So we can obtain this kind of picture graph. H infinity here, gain here. This one is the cooperative solution at the steady state, H at the steady state, profit at the steady state, at all, total profit, sorry. This one is the Nash equilibrium. And these three are the three learning processes. Affine in W, imitation of W, and conjecture in H. We can see that if gamma, because we have symmetric players, we can see that if gamma is low, the procedure gives are worse than Nash equilibrium. From point of view, from the environmental and economic point of view. But choosing gamma, we can see that, at least in these two cases, we can see that we can obtain almost the optimal solution in the far-sighted solution. Of course, the gamma is different for the different procedures. For example, for code for imitation of W is this quantity, and for H is almost the double. Here is a sum of the situation near the far-sighted solution. And here only to show you the trajectories. This is Nash, of course, because it, Nash degrades the resource. The red one is the optimal solution. We can see that the conjecture in H follows almost well the cooperative solution, and the other gives a long term at least better than the steady state of the cooperative solution. And the problem with affine W is at the beginning, follow Nash solution, and then try to follow the cooperative solution. That's why we obtain with this one a worse welfare. But what I want to say with this simulation is that with learning, when players take into account the near future, at least a bit through gamma, we can approach the long-term cooperative behavior. Players do not need to cooperate, do not need to know the player function of the other players, and they can cooperate only, for example, imitating what the other are doing. Okay. And I finish. I hope that I convince you that you must work in conjectural variation equilibrium. No, no. I hope that I convince you that conjectures replace the need of information about other players' payoff. Conjecture can be a way for implicit cooperation in the case of non-cooperative behavior. And we can see conjecture as a meta model that involves different kinds of behaviors. As I try to present here, lots of things have been done. Nevertheless, there is still a lot of things to do. Things to do. I like this because if I put to do together, I find todo. Because we must do all the things. Okay, for example, from the mathematical point of view, we must study the problem with several players, several state variables, the case of constraints that are very difficult to deal, try to work with more complex learning processes, try to put stochasticity in the models. From the economic point of view, we can apply this to very different economic problems. And this model can explain the behaviors in experimental economics and can explain and can be used to explain behavioral economics. For example, a player can think that the other player is conformist or positional. Or pro-social, what are these? Conformists Asian is an Asian that gets joy from doing like others. Positional are Asian that gets joy from contributing above others. And prosocial Asian gets joy when contribution approaches an ideal level. So players can make conjecture and then verify if these conjectures are true, and these are the problem that our economics are very interested in. And I finish. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mabel. Gracias por todo. Excelente la charla. Bueno, ya todos pueden activar sus micrófonos y videos, así podemos aplaudir a Mabel. También tienen ahí un...
muy aproximativo, pero me pareció que era importante hacerlo en inglés.
No, perfecto. Elina, no sé si...
Bueno, iniciamos la sesión de preguntas. Como todos pueden tener sus micrófonos abiertos ya, les sugeriría que si tienen preguntas, se la hagan hablando. Bueno, están todos muy tímidos con las preguntas.
Sí, es la primera, vos tenés que entender, es la primera.
Ahí está Lisandro. Dale, Lisandro.
Bueno, te la hago en español.
Dale, sí, que es más fácil.
No, en el ámbito estocástico, ahí ya supongo que hay desarrollos hechos. Bueno, uno en principio podría pensar que todas esas distintas funciones le podés poner ahí algún parámetro estocástico, pero hay en particular algo que sea, por ejemplo, cuando buscas esa consistencia, que hay como una probabilidad de consistencia o algo así.
Exactamente, es muy difícil la parte, vos decís que hay mucho hecho, no, yo te digo que no hay casi nada hecho en estocástico. Lo único que está probado y yo diría que es matemáticamente habría que aclarar varios puntos, es por ejemplo en los casos de estrategias discretas, los modelos de racionalidad individual con probabilidades, eso sí está probado, poniendo una topología especial está probado que puede ser un equilibrio conjetural consistente, pero ya te digo, en lo que se llama estocástico en tiempo continuo o tiempo discreto, en horizonte, que no sea estático, no conozco resultados con conjeturas. Y yo creo que hay mucho para hacer, porque yo creo que los espacios topológicos no deben ser muy fácil para probar todas las otras cosas que en los casos deterministas son más fáciles. En todo caso, como yo trabajo en eso, me parece más fácil.
Bueno, muchas gracias.
¿Alguna otra pregunta? Entonces pregunto yo, Mabel, los tres tipos de conjeturas que mostraste, ¿se usan esos porque son los más sencillos de obtener resultados analíticos o porque están...?
Yo me he transformado, después que estoy con los economistas, me he transformado en una persona que me gusta hacer primero todas las cosas simples y ver cómo funciona en todos los ejemplos donde puedo encontrar soluciones analíticas, en donde puedo hacer comparaciones y todo lo demás. Entonces, cuando trato de aplicar cosas nuevas que no sé bien lo que me van a dar, realmente, fíjate, el problema que puse, no les mostré las formas funcionales, pero era lineal cuadrático, para poder encontrar rápidamente soluciones que son analíticas. Y efectivamente, en esos problemas lineal cuadráticos, yo ya sé que las soluciones optimales del modelo general en horizonte infinito son funciones lineales de las cosas. Entonces, bueno, lo lógico es pensar que una conjetura va a ser algo lineal. Eso desde el punto de vista matemática. Pero del punto de vista de la inteligencia de la gente, que es bastante limitada, es decir que ellos van a pensar en cosas simples. Y yo creo, porque no lo hago yo, pero lo hacen mis compañeros de trabajo, cuando van a preguntar realmente cómo piensa la gente, y usted, porque si ustedes se creen que la gente va a resolver el modelo en horizonte infinito como nosotros, están muy equivocados, pero ¿cómo hacen para pensar? Y realmente ellos piensan cosas simples. Y Y por eso las cosas lineales que yo he supuesto es por simplicidad. Pero justamente cuando los economistas se pusieron a hacer cosas y trataron de encontrar problemas de punto fijo, no hicieron eso de linealidad. Y por eso la cosa es bastante complicada.
Ok. ¿Más preguntas?
Hay mucho que hacer.
¿Más preguntas?
A ver, yo le pregunto a Mabel, no sé si me escuchan.
Sí,
sí, Mabel, sí, Pablo.
¿Podés dar otros ejemplos de aplicación concreta de esto que puedan ser interesantes?
De todo lo que sea aplicación a recursos naturales, se usa mucho las conjeturas. Y a contribución a bienes públicos y a conservación de energía, a problemas de explotación de diferentes tipos de recursos naturales. Y la idea es que realmente, estaba tratando de pensar otra cosa que yo no hago, pero en finanzas se usa mucho, mucho también como procedimiento.
Claro. Bien. Bien, bien. O sea, todo lo que tenga que ver con el uso de una cosa pública, como vos decías, donde se acoplan todos esos jugadores. ¿Podríamos pensar algo para el tráfico de esto?
Sí, yo diría que sí. Si vos tratás de pensar, cuando hacen tráfico, la gente actúa como resolviendo un problema de Nash.
Parecido.
¿Actúan no cooperativa?
Actúan no cooperativo.
No cooperativo.
Sí. Desde que ellos actúan no cooperativo, desde que ellos no saben lo que van a hacer el otro, y a lo mejor tienen alguna idea de lo que hicieron el año pasado o ayer en el trayecto, y entonces decías, ellos hicieron esto, entonces yo voy a hacer esto otro porque pienso que van a seguir haciendo eso, ya tenés la conjetura. Yo creo que es así, yo creo que la gente usa mucho la conjetura en la cabeza. Piensa algo del otro, porque uno generalmente no piensa como piensa el otro, es muy difícil ponerse... La empatía es muy difícil. Generalmente uno piensa que el otro va a hacer más o menos lo que hacemos nosotros o algo muy parecido. Y bueno, y ahí claro. Nos confundimos.
Bien.
Sí, sí, bueno. La gente utiliza, sea no cooperativa, o sea, la resolución normal del problema, se puede usar usando conjeturas, sí.
Bueno, después te voy a escribir para ver, para
charlar. Dale, dale.
Bien.
Bueno, claro, no sé si hay más preguntas, comentarios para Mabel, si no le agradecemos nuevamente y seguimos con el programa.
Seguimos con la charla. Bueno, cualquier cosa me escriben, ¿eh? Cualquier cosa dale. Me escriben.
Gracias, Mabel. Otro aplauso
gracias
para
a ustedes.
Vos.
Gracias, Mabel. Esta charla igual después va a estar subida en YouTube. Así que si te pueden seguir comentando ahí, preguntando. De última, después te pasamos las preguntas.
Y, al pelo. Muchísimas gracias.
Y también bueno, va a estar subida en el foro para todos los que quieran entrar y verla. Y bueno, y los invito a todos a descansar unos minutitos y entrar después a la sesión plenaria en honor a Domingo Tarcia, que hoy tenemos la charla inaugural.
Al pelo.
Bueno, muchas gracias a todos. Nos vemos en un rato.